It's so good. My name is Phillip Pretorius, and quickly introduce you to my beautiful family. I'm married to Renee, and I've got two boys. The one is 12 years old, and the other one is 5 years old. He thinks he's 12, but he's 5. And Jesse, there's my family. So Jesse is 12 years old, and Luca is 5 years old. My wife Renee, we've been happily married for the past 19 years. I had the privilege of ministering on campus, and a group of students got saved, of which my wife was one of them. So I had the privilege of leading my wife to Christ, and out of the whole group, I just hand-raised one, and made it my wife. No, I'm joking. It is, you know, God is always amazing when we serve God, and I know many of you are visiting us, and some of you are exploring, you know, just who God is. And I hope our stories and who we are, it's just authentic. It's real. It's not something you try to make up. It is the realities of our life, as many of us, and every one of us face different realities. And when we look at things like, you know, those stories, I'm going to tell you a little bit about my family as I minister this morning, because we go through life and all of us sitting here, and life has all these different challenges. There are different things happening in life. There's different things happening in different nations. I mean, we've just gone through election, and our elections has major effect on the pound rand effect. I mean, our rand, I mean, the dollar and everything, all the things in the world has to do with different levels and different spheres of authority and things that happen. Just watched a clip that somebody sent me about, you know, the rugby player and what's happening with him, and, you know, Israel Folau, and different things in the world that are happening all over. In your nation are different things happening. And I believe that if we look at following Jesus, what does it mean when we say we're following Jesus? Now, me and Wolfie went out on Thursday night, and at London Bridge, over the Tower Bridge, we ran into this guy. He had a t-shirt on that says, "Follower." So Wolfie walks up to him and says, "I like your t-shirt. Where do I get one of those?" He says, "Who are you following?" He says, "No, I follow myself." It's like, and Wolfie looked at him and says, "That's practically impossible. How do you follow yourself?" Imagine this quickly, just stop here. Who of you sitting here and you know that you're perfect? How on earth do you want to follow yourself? I mean, how do you want to follow imperfection and keep on going deeper into imperfection? You see, but all of us do want to follow something. We're not just buying the t-shirt because it's something abstract. It is a deep need in every single human being's soul. You want to associate. You want to belong. You want your rugby team to win. You want your football, almost say soccer again. So in our context, we call it soccer, okay? But you want your football teams to win. You want whatever you associate with. Your kids go to the best school, and there's another school around the corner. I mean, we want to be associated to things that are successful. That is part of our nature. You see, being a follower is that's natural, that's normal. We should be followers. But the problem is, if we don't know what to follow and how follow means, and what it means when we really follow, we may think that we are following something right, and ultimately it has a destructive effect on our lives. The Bible takes us through different aspects of understanding the degrees of following. And one scripture I just want to quote in Acts 1 verse 8, Jesus said, "All authority," he's talking about authority, he says, "when you receive power," authority, "when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and that power is for a purpose, you will be my witnesses." That word authority, that word power, is talking about an explosive power. It means, I'll tell you some stories. I was, years back, I was invited to a little small town, and there were a few guys, like 30 guys, meeting young people, meeting in this room. I walked in there, and we were about to just share with them about Jesus and how to follow Jesus. And there were one guy there with cancer. God said to me, "Go up to this person and pray for him." So I walked up to the guy. I've never met him before. I asked him, "What's wrong?" He says, "No, I've got cancer, and the doctor's given me 3 months to live." I said, "Would you mind? Can I pray for you?" Now, no human being can actually heal anybody. We don't have the power. But only when we become a vessel, when we become like a pipe, You know, a pipe channels water. It channels things, flow through it. We're just a pipe. I laid my hands and I prayed for him. We had the privilege of going back to the same place 2 months later. And I walked up and he wasn't there. And I saw his sister and I said, hey, where's your brother? In my heart, I was hoping he's not passed away. So he says, have you not heard? I said, no. He says, my brother went back to the doctor and he was perfectly, absolutely healed. There's no trace of cancer in his body. Now, no human being can do that. You see, there's a power, there's a dynamos, there's an explosion of a reality of the creator of the universe in somebody's face that brings you to the reality of your own heart and your own life, and you need to make a decision. You see, if we believe it or not, go and ask Peter who got healed if he believes it or not, because he had cancer. Nobody can argue against that kind of testimony. So that's one power we see, and that is a powerful power. It has an ability, but it's got a specific purpose. Explosions don't build. Explosions open up. There's a different kind of power. And if you think about power, every human being on the face of the earth wants to have power. They want to be the top sports hero. Why? It's not just because you love sport. They want to be the owner of the business. They want to be the top. And many times, there's things in our lives we want to be there because we want to have financial power, relational power. We want to have this thing that we can express. And power itself, by itself, is not a problem. It's the purity. It's the purpose of it. If I give you my credit card, it's in my bag, and I say, I give you authority, you can spend £1,000 a month. You have certain authority given to you. Doesn't mean it's your money, it just means you've been given authority to use it. If I give it to you, you go over £1,000, you go £2,000, I withdraw my authority. I close this, I said, no, you no longer can do this. Why? Because you've been given authority, but it's limited authority. See, the problem is not authority, the problem is can man live within restraint to what God has called us? Can man live within restraint that we have limited authority and it has a purpose, and if we step out of its purpose, we no longer need the authority. You go down the street and you find this traffic police jumps out and he stops you. I mean, you're driving a big truck. Why do you stop? I mean, if you drive down another street and here's Sonny, just a man in normal clothes, jump in front of you and he raises his hand, you're also going to stop, but not because you have to. It's because you're afraid you're going to run over this guy. But when a traffic police stands and you stop in fear and trembling, what's the difference? No man has the authority to stop a truck. But you know, if I don't obey this man, behind him is a whole government. His authority is not his own. It's delegated authority. And because of that, we respect that. See, true authority can never be rooted in self, my own opinion, and what I see and what I believe, because I'm so captured within my own mind and my own brain, and I'm so limited to my own leading, feeling, following self, that I can never get to the other side unless there is a greater source, there's a greater force that I submit myself to and I understand. Where do I get this? See, any human authority on earth, from police to government, from nations, from the USA to the UK, you can take any kind of authority and you can name them and you can make a list, and every single one of them are limited. We look at governments and we look at nations and say, oh, we hope this nation, this, in our context, I mean, just now with the elections, people were hoping that the government is actually going to save us. And the reality is, before elections and after elections, it's never going to happen. Because governments can't save people. They should govern, but they won't save. There's a limited authority to human institutions. But there's a greater authority available to us. A well-known scripture, Matthew 28, verse 18. Jesus comes and he says, all authority. You understand the word all? Now, I know I speak a different English than you, okay. All in Greek, all in Hebrew means all. That's what it means. It means it's all. It means there is no other authority apart from it. all authority in heaven and earth belongs to one God, the only God, the true God. He says, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. That means he has all authority and he wants to distribute. He wants to channel this authority in the right way. Now, this authority is not like the word dynamos in Acts 1, which is an explosive authority. You pray for somebody to get healed and you have this explosive moments where people face the reality of a supernatural almighty God. This is a different type of authority. The word authority here comes from the original meaning, which is the word exousia, which means it is the complete ability, the total mastering pure power. It's the highest form and demonstration of God's authority on earth. It expands beyond all authorities and it leaves nothing from its influence. Let me say this again. This authority, the meaning of all authority here means it is the complete ability, the mastering pure power, the greatest influence that leaves nothing from its influence. That's the power that Jesus is talking about here. The reason why we're sitting here is not just because we made a choice. The reason why we're part of a family that's in all over the world in maybe 80 nations now is not just because we made a choice. The reason why the Church of God exists throughout generations, over 2,000 years, is not just man's choice. It is an authority on earth that is absolutely at work and visible, and no man can ever argue either way. It's not going to happen because it is not limited and it's not controlled and it's not actioned by man. It's not under man's authority. It is authority way above man. You see, there's something about the absoluteness of God that when we understand it and even we struggle our soul because our human hearts, normal human hearts, I don't know about you, but me, Phillip, I battle with authority. I battle many times when God says go left, I kind of want to go right. You know, it's like right. I mean, my youngest son, he's 5 years old. I don't know what it is in kids. I know your kids don't do that, but mine, I mean, if I say sit, he wants to stand. There's nothing about sitting, standing, but if I say lie down, he wants to get up. It's like, what is it? There's something inside of the soul of the human heart that just hates authority. But here's the irony about it. We don't really hate authority because we want it. We just don't want to submit to it. You see, whom if you want justice to be done? Whom if you want, when things are wrong in government, a minister does wrong, you want him to be judged. If somebody, a criminal does something, you want him to be judged. Whom if you want justice? Would you like justice over your life? No. When I'm on the other side, the receiving end, no. Let's slow down. You see, there's something about the human condition that cannot solve itself. It cannot remedy itself. It cannot heal itself. It needs something on the outside. It needs a higher force. It needs a higher power. And it's available. He says, all authority, this complete, powerful, master, pure power is available and it belongs not to man and it will never belong to any man, any government, any institution. It only belongs to the creator of the universe, one God. It belongs to God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And one, how do we operate in this power? He says, go and make disciples of all nations. See, what happens is the moment you realize, and if you've been a Christian for a long time, you live in this nation, I want to ask you today to listen with open heart. There's something about the church that we come to a moment like this and there's a gathering. And some of you, maybe you're the first time here and it's almost like you've never been in an environment like this. I want to explain to you that the real power of the church is not just this moment. The power of the church is on the other side of the pulpit. The power of the church is when every believer on the face of the earth avail themselves to allow this exousia power to start to flow through them in your workplace, in your families, on the sports fields, in your families, in your relationships. And there's a display of God in society that is as normal, but it's supernatural. And it affects people's lives. When Jesus said, go make disciples, it was not something we have to go and do. It was the greatest display of his authority through sinful, imperfect man fulfilling his perfect plan. See, when we as human beings, we all struggle with this, and that includes myself. We have this tendency to get through situations, and we are humbled by those situations, and just after the situation, we get back on the throne, and we fill ourselves up with pride again. I admit, if you talk about authority and you talk about this, I mean, it's important that we understand what authority is. And I want to give you a few examples. This is water, pure water. You see, God's authority is pure. You give it to people. The reason why many people don't want God, because they don't know God. So you can't really, you see, what is holiness? Holiness is not in this sad we see on movies and everything. They talk about holiness and your holiness. And this. What is holiness? Holiness is not the way you dress and the way you talk and the way you walk. Let me explain to you holiness. If I give you two diamonds, the one diamond is perfect. Ladies, beautiful, perfect. The other diamond's got so many defaults, and it's just not a good diamond. And I give you an option. You don't have to pay for it. I'm going to give you a perfect diamond or an imperfect diamond. Which one are you going to choose? All of you say? Perfect. Hey, guys, if I give you a perfect woman and an imperfect woman, which one are you going to choose? Hey, if I give you a perfect business and an imperfect business, which one are you going to choose? If I give you a perfect school and an imperfect school, which one are you going to choose? You will always choose perfection. Why? Because you're created to live holy. What is perfection? It's the irresistible perfection. Irresistible perfection of God. When you see it, you cannot resist it. That's why religion blurs true Christianity. It gives you a human side to what it's not. And if you're visiting here today, sorry for what religion has maybe done in your perspective of God. There is an absolute perfect, irresistible beauty about the creator of the universe with zero, not one even ill motive. That's why we say he doesn't have love. He is love, which means he is absolutely the source of perfection in his motive. He has no ill motive with you. He's holy. He's perfect in his character. He's perfect in his motive. Why would you not trust him? You see, when you look at authority, we say we want authority. Oh, how do I get this authority? You see, authority is like this beautiful clean water. And then we say, just give human beings the authority. And then, all right, so I want to volunteer. Can I have a volunteer who wants a sip of this? Hey, it's the same authority. Why do we battle on earth with all kinds of stuff in society today? Why is it when somebody stands for the truth, they are persecuted? Why is it when somebody may raise another standard, they're persecuted? Because in a world where everybody is their own God and everybody has their own authority, it is just a mess. The moment mankind disconnects him from the Creator, he will lose his creation purpose. He will not understand why we're here. There's no way on earth we could ever come back to a clear understanding of this unless we come back to the one who designed us. If you have a problem with your iPhone, your Samsung, You don't take that to the Nike store. You take that back to the Apple store and say, please, would you fix this thing? It's got a virus on. Okay, no, apples don't get virus. That's why. I mean, see, I'm apostolic, sorry. So, I mean, you go back to Samsung and say, fix this thing. It's got a problem. Here's the problem, why we keep on having problems and live in problems. That's why we battle with our minds. We battle with our soul. We battle with our feelings. We battle in our minds, mentally. We battle. Why? You just need to go to the Creator to be fixed. There is no other place to be fixed. I grew up in an environment where I saw my grandfather. I was a little boy, 5 years old, driving on the farm. And I would see one day, I remember we were driving down the farm and it started hailing. And I'm 5 years old. My grandfather pulled off his truck and he prays to a God. And remember, I'm 5 years old. I don't know this. He prays to a God. He gets out. He says, Lord, you've asked me not to insure. You've asked me. You said you'll protect my crop. I'm not saying you shouldn't insure. I said what God spoke to him at that season of his life. And as he was praying, the hail stops on the fence. I'm a little 5-year-old boy. Now you may say, you know, I tell you what my personal experience, and I saw the authority of God even with weather. One day I sat with my grandfather, I had a wart on my finger, and I showed him. He says, this is what we do when people are sick. We pray for them. He put his finger on my finger, he prayed for me, and when he took it away, it was gone. I came back from a mission trip one day in my home, and my son, every single time I go on a mission trip when Jesse was young, I get back every time he's sick. And I realized this is not normal. So we can fight this in a normal way. We go to doctors and you just make them reach, or you do a lot of stuff. And so I got back home and I said, Lord, I know in your nation, maybe not, we pay. Okay? Right. But I got back home and I realized, I mean, this is not wrong. This is not normal. But because I'm just a channel, because I know something much greater than me, I know authority that's way beyond my limitations, because in my limitations, I'm in fear, I'm in trembling, I am limited, I cannot do something, I go into depression on my own. I look onto something that's way bigger than myself. And I prayed for my son, said, Lord, I'm asking you not just to heal him. He had rotavirus. Rotavirus is something that kids, there's no medicine, they take them into hospital, they keep them there till they're healed. The doctor said to us, you have to bring him in. She has never seen someone get healed outside of hospital. I put my hands on him. I said, Lord, before we take him to hospital, I'm going to ask you to heal him. We drove to the hospital. The doctor checked him, says, he's healed. There's nothing wrong. Story upon story upon story. It would be irrational for me not to believe. It is so rational for me to believe. Because I'm not trying to make something up. I'm telling you about the reality of a creator out there who is behind every one of you's existence. You see, when we talk about authority, I live in Africa. If you jump into a lion's den, even if you don't believe he has authority, you will change your mind very quickly. Even if you think you're stronger, you may change your mind while you're in the cage. You see, here's the difference. When you're outside of the cage, you have respect. When you're inside the cage, respect turns into fear. Why? It doesn't matter what political party you're part of. Doesn't matter how many companies you own. When you get in the cage, you're going to be messed up. Because there's authority, there is a power in that cage that's way beyond even your belief system. Because it's the truth. See, what we believe does not mean it's true. It just means that is what determines how we live our lives. Doesn't mean it's true. Friends, God is calling us to a place where our belief will be rooted in something bigger than me, myself, and I. It's a very small package. Our truth is rooted in something much bigger. You see, this God that we serve, he is the only remedy to the morality of society. It's not just having authority. Can I have authority? It's what will the channel where the authority flows through look like? He is the only solution that can sort out the morality of mankind. Nothing else can sort out problems. Everybody wants to bring solutions, but nobody can redeem the morality of mankind. He is the only one that can give us lasting freedom. He is the only one that can give us everlasting change and fulfillment. Two needs that every human being has on the face of the earth. You have those needs. They're legitimate needs. The need for acceptance and the need for significance. The need to belong, to be loved. And the second need that you have that's legitimate is a need to have a purpose on earth. That's why you work. That's why you get up. That's why you get married. You want to be loved and you want to have purpose. That's why you're here. You want to belong and you want to have a purpose. Those are legitimate needs. They're godly needs. But the problem comes when you meet legitimate needs in an illegitimate way, you go into idolatry. Find your acceptance in your Creator, God. And when you're accepted by Him and you know accepted, no human rejection can derail you because you're accepted by authority above human beings. It is your Creator. Find your significance in God and not in what you do and not in your title, not in your race, not in your language. You find your significance in the Creator of the universe and you walk on earth with a total different perspective. So here's the difference. When we are looking for acceptance, we will always go to places where we want to find acceptance. We want to get something. We want to get significance. But when you find your acceptance in God, and you don't do this once off, you do this daily. When you find your significance in God, you're not a taker anymore. You become a giver of acceptance, a giver of significance. And we become people who selflessly, generously spend our lives so that others can meet their Maker. That's why we're on earth, friends. This authority is released the moment you and I go. And I want to end with this scripture. 1 John 5, verse 4 and 5. For everyone who is born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that overcomes the world, our faith. Who is that overcomes the world? Except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. How do I get this authority? How does this authority affect my life? And every one of us sitting here, if you have a quiet moment now and you think, is there one need in your life you identify? Everyone will have a need. Every one of us, there's something in our soul we still need. How do we get this Creator of God, Creator in our lives, involved in our lives? He says, everyone born of God. As much as you're sitting here and you are born as a human being, you are born in the same way. You need to be born again means that there comes a moment in your life where you put your faith in the Creator of the universe. You put your faith in Jesus Christ. And you accept what He's done for you. You embrace Him as the Lord of your life. That literally say, Lord, here's my life. It's a place where God comes into your life and human beings don't have the authority. He comes into our life and God Himself positions His ability Himself in us that starts to affect our lives and through our lives, it affects people's lives. Therefore, it says God in us, the hope of glory. Christ in us, the hope of glory. See, when we are born of God, how do we get that? By faith in Christ. Christ Jesus, what He did for us. And as we talk about Jesus, the simplicity of Jesus, the message we talk about Jesus, we talk about what He did for us. As you go and you're on a business visa to South Africa, let's make it USA, and you mess up and they put you in jail because you broke the law. The moment you broke the law, you lost your business visa rights. You have no more rights. And somebody else comes in and he says, you know what? How much is the bail? How much is it to pay you out? No, it's 100,000 pounds. And a friend of yours comes in and he says, I'm going to pay the 100,000 pounds. Will you be thankful? Now, did you pay? No, you didn't. Did somebody pay? Yes. Are you free? Yes, you are free. But you're not free because you did something. You're free because somebody else did something. Although it's free, it's not cheap. And when it comes to Jesus, that's exactly the point. Jesus knows the condition of mankind. He knows the condition of nations. And all he's asking, would you humble yourself? See, pride is the one thing that resists God. When you humble yourself and say, Lord, thank you. Acceptance, you've forgiven me of my sins. And then you embrace God that you are my future. You embrace the check that was signed and to pay for your sins. The moment you allow God to pay for and you embrace he has paid, there's a freedom that comes to your soul that you cannot get through human effort. Friends, every one of us, you may be journeying with God for a long time. Some of you exploring who God is. This message is relevant and applicable to wherever you are on your journey. If you've been knowing God for a long time, God has called you to live by this exousia power, a pure power that can affect people's lives. It's almost like Bill Gates comes and says, I'm going to build a $200 million building right next door. And he says, you're going to be my project leader. You're never going to wonder who's going to pay the bills because Bill Gates said, if Jesus says, go and make disciples, he's saying, I have all authority. I'll pay the checks. He's called us to go and make a difference. It's not by your own power. The greatest thing that we need to discover today in the midst of everything about God is when we humble ourselves, we start to see more of God. As human beings, we're nothing without God. If you're sitting here and you're on a journey, you may not know everything, but there's one thing I encourage you today. Humble yourself and put your faith in Christ. It doesn't have to make sense. You don't have to study everything about a lion to understand a lion is powerful. There's something when you embrace God, he becomes visible more in your life. Let's close our eyes. Father, I thank you for this morning. Holy Spirit, thank you that you're here. In our own human ability, we are so limited. Father, as we silence our spirit and our soul before you, we pray that you speak to every one of us. If you're sitting here this morning and you've been coming, you've been invited, or maybe it's your first time, I'm asking you just to allow you as a human being, you were created by God. And even as I was speaking, something in your soul is yearning for it to be connected with your Creator. You may not understand everything, but in your soul, deep inside of you, there's an emptiness. And you want God to fill that place. You've tried to fill it with so many different things. Only fulfillment will come when God takes his position in your heart. If you're sitting here this morning and you want to put your faith in Jesus, I want to help you in a simple way to do this. In simplicity, it's just you. Say, Lord, I choose to put my faith in you this morning. I want to turn to you. If that is you, would you like to raise your hand? Anybody? Is there anybody who feels like that? If you're still on a journey, I want to encourage you, continue with that. And allow God to take you deep into it. If you're sitting here this morning and you're sure that you are born again, but you live in a city like this and we get so busy, we get so wrapped up with things around us and we get so busy, God is calling you to start to make a difference even more so. Even if you've been making a difference, God is calling you to say, come to me. And there's an authority as we reach out, deliberate, build relationships with people out there so that we can influence them and affect their lives through discipling them. I want to pray for you. Father, I pray this morning for your church. I pray this morning for people here, God, that know you, that love you. that have maybe become weary. The burdens of life has weighed them down. I pray this morning, Father, for a faith to arise in their soul again. I pray for a new hope, God. I pray, Father, that there will be a new stirring in their spirit. Lord, to first devote themselves to you and find their fulfillment in you, God. And through that, God, I pray for reprioritizing, restructuring their lives, God. To make margin, to make room, God. To do what you've called us to do. To have the effect on earth. What you've called us to have on earth, Father. There are so many people out there that are waiting for the display of your disciples on earth. And Lord, I pray that the exousia power will fill this church. And as people start to go, we will see a supernatural power flow in and through us. We pray this in Jesus' name.